TheYeshiva.net.
Okay, Torah Oir, Parshas Miketz, page 72. It's a Chanukah Maimer. The Maimarim of the Yomim Tovim usually were inserted into the Parshias when the Yomim Tovim take place. So the Maimarim of the Baal HaTanya, of the Alter Rebbe on Chanukah, are in Parshas Vayeshev and in Parshas Miketz, because usually Chanukah coincides with these two Parshias. This year, actually, Chanukah began Mitzoy Shabbos, Parshas Vayeshev, and continues throughout Parshas Miketz. So this Maimer was inserted into Parshas Miketz. You'll see it's mamash on the bottom of the page, 72, column 2, the last two lines, or Daf Lamed Vav, Amud Dalet, Lamed Vav, column 4 on the bottom. And it starts off with a pasuk that L'cha'oire, it wouldn't seem very connected to Chanukah, but as we shall see and discover, it's a profound connection to Chanukah. Now, just as an intro, this maimer, which begins with the words Rani v'Simchi Bas Tzion, which is from the Haftorah that is going to be said on Shabbos Chanukah, was said by the Baal HaTanya, by the Alter Rebbe, on Shabbos Chanukah of the year Tovkuf Samach Vav. Tovkuf Samach Vav, which would be 1805. Now this maimer actually, when it finishes on the next page, 74, you'll see on the second column it says Biur Al Hanal, and there's a whole other maimer which is Biur Al Hanal until you get to Lamed Ches, where there's a new maimer Mika Hashem Elokeinu. Very often the Alter Rebbe had a minig that he would say a maimer, and then in the next, it could be next Shabbos, or it could be a day later, it could be a few days later, he would say what was called a biur on the Maimer, an explanation on the Maimer. And in these biurim, he showed the foundations upon which his first Maimer was built. He showed, usually the second, the biurim are much more complex and much more mystical, because he basically shows how he got to the ideas in the first Maimer. Usually in his Maimarim, he conveys his ideas. He doesn't trace back his methodology and formula of thinking of how he developed ideas. In his Biurim, which were usually said for a more select group of people who were masters, both of Halacha and Kabbalah, he would trace back the ideas to the writings of the Arizal, to other writings of Kabbalah, Zohar, and develop it. So it was more winding, more complex, more subtle, showing, that's why it was called an explanation. It's not always an explanation, sometimes it's harder, because he's trying to trace back the ideas, but in that process he would also explain things more. So that's why a lot of the Maimarim at the end have actually a beer, just for reference, for your own knowledge. So we're going to start the Maimar here, Rani v'Simchi Basir, Kihinini Va. Now, what is this pasuk? How does it come in here? You see, page 72, two lines from the bottom.
Yes.
Yeah. How does it come in here? L'chayda, what's the connection? Rani v'simchi bas tzion is a pasuk in Scharia. In Scharia, Perek Beis, pasuk Yud Dalet. It's the opening words of the Haftarah of Shabbos Chanukah. And what it means is, Rani, dance, v'simchi, rejoice, daughter of Tzion, daughter of Zion, kihini niva, because I'm coming. And I will dwell among you, God says. And many nations will come to Hashem. This is the beginning of the Haftarah of Shabbos Chanukah. There's something surprising here. Because just a few psukim later, Pasuk Yud Zayin, Perek Beis ends in Scharia, and now starts Perek Gimel. And Perek Gimel is the continuation of the Haftarah, which tells the famous story about Yehoshua, who was a Kohen Gadol during the beginning of Bayis Sheni. And basically the Navi Scharia has a whole prophecy about him, and that prophecy includes a description of a menorah and a menorah burning, which is a continuation of the Nevuah in Perek Gimel and Perek Dalet, which that would seem connected to Chanukah. And yet the Haftarah inserts a few psukim from a previous chapter that completely don't discuss Chanukah, they don't discuss the prophecy that deals with the menorah. And that's his pella here, his question on which he builds the maimer, why that was inserted into the Haftarah of Chanukah. Now the interesting thing here is, this would seem like an incidental detail in Chanukah that doesn't capture its essence, but nonetheless, it is often in Yiddishkeit that from a nuance, you somehow can get perspective on essential ideas, and this is an example for it. Most people between you and I don't notice what the Haftarah of Shabbos Chanukah is. If they already lived through Kriyas HaTorah, it's already a big miracle. By the time of the Haftarah, you know, it's already the Kiddush. So that even those who concentrate on the Haftarah don't bother to look up where the Haftarah was taken and why they chose this Haftarah. Okay, but that's because we don't, you know, most people don't even know how powerful and insightful these things are. But obviously for him it was different. So, but L'chayda doesn't seem a pasuk at the beginning of the Haftarah, but he's going to show how you have to say that these psukim, even though L'chayda they're not connected, they actually convey a major theme of Chanukah, and that's going to be the connection.
At face value, why wouldn't this sentence make sense to fit into Chanukah? Chanukah Sabayas, and we gained the Chanukah Samikdash, we're coming back in, so Kihina Niva, we're going to be doing this all over again now, we're going to have the Kabbalahs, everything's coming back, so why wouldn't that face
right.
value just fit in?
Because I'll tell you, there's a lot of Nevuahs like this. The Nevi'im are full of these Nevuahs. Phil. So if you have a Pedic, and we're not doing this whole Pedic. The Pedic comes also before. The Pedic, Prozestation of Yerushalayim, there's a lot of stuff before it. That he doesn't say. He starts off with this Pasuk. That means this Pasuk essentially is connected to Chanukah. The concept that you're saying is true. But that concept you already have before in the Pedic. He doesn't choose it. He starts from these Pesukim, which is the middle of a Pedic, and then goes over to a new Pedic, which Taka is going to deal with the Chanukah, with the Menorah of the Beis HaMikdash, which is obviously connected directly. So that's going to be his proof that this pasuk somehow conveys, and it's the opening message of the Haftarah of Chanukah. So Rani v'Simchi Vasiyah and Kehini Niva. Lahavin Inyan Rani v'Simchi. Pashut, understand what this means. Rani v'Simchi, dance, rejoice, and what's the difference between the two? V'Gam Ma'in is al Haftarah Chanukah. And also, what's the connection between this pasuk and Haftarah of Chanukah? Shemaschilin b'Rani v'Simchi. V'Yitzarich Lahaschem in Ra'isi v'Hini Menoyd Azov Kula Shebesayfa Parsh. The first question is, what is Rani and Simchi? What's the difference between dancing? Rani is from the word Rina and Simcha. What's the two expressions? Is Rani and the Simchi? The second thing is, what's the connection to Chanukah? L'chayda, the beginning of the Haftarah should have been with Ra'isi, V'hini, Menor, Zav, Kula, which is directly connected to Chanukah. Because that's the Iker of the Nes in the Menorah. In fact, the Gemara Masech, the Megillah at the end, recounts and enumerates what we do for Haftarah. So when it comes to Chanukah, the Gemara says in Megillah that on Chanukah maftirin b'neiris de Scharia. The Haftarah is about the neiris of Scharia Hanavi. So Rashi says over there, neiris de Scharia, Rami v'simchi al shem re'isi v'inim b'neiris of kula. So it's because neiris of Scharia, which is the menorah, and yet we begin, as Rashi points out, from the pasuk Rami v'simchi. V'inyinu, the explanation in all of this is, and now he's going to completely change the subject. And at the end of the Maimon, he's going to come back. He's going to come back to Chanukah. So there's a major build-up here. A major build-up is going to be. And then at the end, he's going to come back to Rani v'Simchi Basin and show the connection to Chanukah and show how this actually conveys one of the most essential themes of Chanukah, this pasuk. Diksiv, for this we have to understand another pasuk. And this is a pasuk we say every single morning in davening. Ivdu es Hashem b'simcha, boyu l'fon of birnana. In Tehillim, Kapitel Kuf, we say it right after Baruch Sha'amar, Mizmer l'soyda hariyu l'Hashem kol ha'aretz, Ivdu es Hashem b'simcha, boyu l'fon of birnana. What does this mean? Serve Hashem with joy, come before Him, birnana. How do they translate birnana in the English Siddurim? Probably with
singing.
With singing, with jubilation. V'isa b'zoya. On this, there's a fascinating expression in Zohar. Chelik Aleph, Daf Reish Chaf Tes, Zog de Zohar. Simcha b'tzafra. Rinona b'ramsa. The Zohar says, Simcha is in the morning. In Aramaic, tzafra is morning. Ramsa is evening, night. So the Zohar says, Simcha is in the morning. And Ranana singing is at night. That's what the Zohar says. Ivdu es Hashem b'simcha is in the morning. Boil the fun of Birnana is Biramsa in the evening, Erev. But Tzarech Lohavin, Mao Tzafra, Mao Ramsa, Mao Simcha, Mao Renana. Zoya says the two are connected. What is it? What is morning? What is night? What is Simcha? What is Renana? And then we can understand why Simcha is in the morning and Renana is at night. What does the Zoya mean with this? So for this, he explains now the concepts of Rina versus Simcha and Yoim versus Laila. Day versus night, morning versus evening. V'yuvan b'hagdim, this will be understood by an introduction. Ki moidaz ois it's knowing, sha'avoydas ha-malochim, hirina v'zimra b'shiriz v'sishbachas. When Chazal talk about the malochim, the angels, they tell us that the malochim, their service of Hashem, consists of rina, of singing, and of zimra, of melodies, and of shirois, of praises, and tishbachos, extolling God. So when we speak about avodas hamalachim, we speak about rina, they're singing. Kenoida, where do we see this? Kenoida meinyan perek shira. We know this from perek shira. Familiar with perek shira, right? Perek shira is, Chazal tell us, that all the bruyim, all the creatures, every morning, they have a shira. Once you get to hear it sometimes, if you wake up early enough, right? You hear everyone is singing. People are sleeping, but everybody is singing. They never have a problem waking up. They're always there before the sicken. And everybody has a niggin. So the perek shira goes through many, many of the animals. What does the frog sing about in the morning? And what does this bird sing? And this animal and that animal? It's fascinating. It's called perek shira. Especially we see this by the malachim. That in all of the worlds the malachim say shira. Really in perek shira we see all creatures. This is what they do. What they do with their life is they're busy saying shira. They're busy singing. All the malachim in all the worlds, to the highest world, to the highest level, they're always saying, they're all saying shiras v'sishbachas with song and jubilation. You have many madregas in malachim. We look at an angel, you know, a white-winged creature who flies around, a lakshon kugel eater. A malach really is a very subtle idea, which we'll see. And every malach lives in its own world. Depends which world. There's different types of worlds, different types of malachim. But he says the common denominator is they're saying shira. V'zimra. Shira and zimra. That's what we say every morning. Tis baruch lanetzach, right? Yishtabach shim chalad malkeinu Hashem esharis of kulam oimdim. Mashmiyim bekel divre lekim chayim. So kulam ahovim kulam brudim. And then we say, poischim espiyim b'shira v'zimra mevorchim m'shabchim m'fardim m'aritzim. And this is the whole introduction to Krishna, as we will see, to understand that the malachim are singing Hashem, Akel, Amelech, Agadol, Mekab, Malei, Malach. They're very dramatic words, very poetic, powerful words. I mean, unfortunately, when you say something every day, you don't stop to think about it. But it's a whole experience that's being described, and somehow, the Chazal who instituted the Nusach HaTfilah, the Berachas Krishna, felt that this is apropos each morning to tune in to this type of song of the malachim, until they finally explode, Kaddish, 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 and that's the Srafim, and then there's the Ifanim and Chayas HaKaddish. They have another Nusach, Baruch Kved Hashem Em Kaim, and then we say, Lekel Baruch Ni'imais Yaitenus, Yaitenus Miris Yameir, V'Zashbachis Yashmeir. And that ultimately finishes the first bracha, then we get into another bracha, Avas Oilam Haftan, or Avarab, it depends on the Nusach, but the point is the love to us, HaBoichav HaMishol B'Av, and then you say Shema Yisrael. What is this singing all about? What are they doing exactly? What is this? That they don't know what to do with their life, so they have to occupy their time. So they sing, what are they supposed to do? What is this concept? He says, V'inyin rinazu, when we speak about this type of rina, hi gilui, oitzim tshukasa. Basically, it's an expression of their intense tshuka. You know what tshuka is, yeah? Their intense
desire,
pining, their intense pining and yearning. L'yisnichsef avagam kol sanafsham. Paraphrasing a pasuk in Tehillim, they have kisufim. Kisufim is a craving. A kisufim is a nichsef nichsafta. Nichsef of a gamkol sanafshi. They have a profound yearning, and their soul yearns and pines. Ladovka by Yisbarach to connect with Him. Blessed be He. Uli iskalal ba'orein soif baruchu. And to become included, to become submerged, to become nichlal, to become part of a klal, from the word klal. To become part of the oneness of the light of infinity, blessed be He. The term He uses here for Hashem is, as usually, doesn't use the word God. Doesn't even usually use the word Ribbono Shel Olam, very rarely. The term that's used is Ein Sof Baruch Hu. Ein Sof means infinity. In the presence, in the light is presence, in the expression of infinity, they want to be submerged. V'tamid kol yemehem. And this is not something they have an inspiration once a year. They get excited about God. This is a craving, a yearning that is not interrupted. They actually don't have any other love. They don't have any other desire. They don't have another ava. Their only ava, their only experience of emotion is, I want to be part of the Ein Sof. I want to be nichlal in the Ein Sof. I want to be part of infinity, completely absorbed. Ein lem ava tshuk acher. So it's kol yemeyim. It's tamid. It's constantly. It's perpetual. V'gam ein lem avoida acheres. Not only don't they have another desire, we have different desires. We have different voids that we try to fill in different ways. We have different cravings. We have different aspirations. So therefore, even though there's a place in the human psyche, in the human soul, that has this, it may not be consciously experienced. By the Malachim and the Bruyim, there is no other Ava and Shuka. This is their soul Ava. So that's why they're always singing. So they're singing. Singing is a form over here of yearning. Singing is a form as I'm trying to touch something. I'm trying to connect to something. It's a manifested expression of the souls of the angels yearning and craving to be one with God completely, to be completely absorbed in the Ein Sof Baruch Hu. That's what singing is. V'gam ein lem avoda acheres. They also have no other avoda kamoi Torah or mitzvahs. Malachim don't have an avoda of Torah and mitzvahs. She'em prines am shachem al ma'ilu lamato. Torah and mitzvahs is actually the avoda of bringing down godliness, milmaila, from above, lamata, down. In other words, Torah and mitzvahs is about sanctifying the world, bringing it down. They don't have that other avoda. Their whole avoda is going up, not coming down. By human beings, first of all, we have other loves, so we're not always singing. We're singing, but seeing the question is, what's the niggun? Besides that, they have no other avoda in ruchnius. Their soul avoda is the yearning, the craving, the seeking. So mele the niggun. They have no avoda of Torah and mitzvahs, which is the opposite direction of bringing the shechina down through Torah and mitzvahs.
But they come down a ladder also. They go up the ladder and they come down.
Yeah. It's a different type of coming down, yeah. Their avoda is the ishtoikikus, the yearning of the soul. Not milmaila lamata, but milmata lamaila. I'm in a lower space and I'm striving to go free, to release myself, to extricate myself and go into a higher. This regesh of tshuka is expressed through singing. K'noida me'inyin hanigin. As it's known to those who understand the concept of a niggun, the concept of a song, the concept of a melody, shu inyan is spilus halev. A niggun is basically as the heart emotes. In yearning, the person sings. Ki yesh niggun shal simcha, vi yesh niggun shal meridus. There are different types of niggun. There's a niggun that has within it a tnua, a motion of joy, of celebration. There's a niggun that has in it a motion of meridus. Meridus is frustration. A sense of bitterness, a sense of melancholy, an angst that the person is experiencing. Huh?
The blues.
Yeah. Yeah. But the common denominator is a niggun is a spilus halev, meaning when the heart, so to speak, explodes in a powerful feeling, in a powerful emotional experience. The person naturally bursts out of niggun. He's not talking here about robotic singing. Now we're going to sing a song, let's start singing. He's talking here about the niggun that comes, that grows out organically from the human being's heart. It comes whenever there's a very deep emotion, but depends what type of emotion. Some emotions will produce a niggun of simcha, and some emotions will produce a niggun of mirirus. So therefore, by the malachim, you also have different types of niggunim. But the common denominator is that there's an element of hispilus halev of tshuka.
Sometimes with instruments?
Of course. So machlekes and mesechta erkin. Every day there was a concerto in the Beis HaMikdash. It's hard for us to understand. There was a huge symphony that went on. You can have 120 vocalists. You understand? 120 vocalists standing on the steps by the ulam. In the morning and in the afternoon, when they did the carbon in the morning and carbon in the afternoon, there was a whole major, and you had instruments and you had vocalists. So the whole machlekes and masechta erkin of the ikir shira is bepeh, or the ikir shira is bekli. if the main avodah of the shir was with the mouth, the vocalist, or was bekli with the instruments, right? And many poskim hold that the ikkah is bekli with the instruments, which in some ways is even deeper than with the mouth. It's even deeper in them in some ways. I'll call upon him. So this is the common denominator of every single type of niggun, and this is the concept of the malachim see. Now, of course, when he says yesh niggun zasimchi, yesh niggun shamiris, as he brings elsewhere, very often one niggun has both. That's the power of some niggunim. One niggun has stanzas that are filled with simcha, stanzas that are filled with meriris, or first meriris usually, and then simcha, and then a deeper meriris, and then a deeper simcha. Some of the niggunim, but niggunim are about a tension. Every niggun, for it to be a powerful niggun, there's a tension. There's a tension that is either resolved or increased. Either the tension is resolved or increased, but it's a tension of the lave is yearning for something. Does it reach it? Does it experience it? How much does it experience it? To what extent does it experience it? And when it experiences it, that itself comes through the previous tension, and this is the hispilus alev that's expressed through a niggun.
About when a neshama goes up.
Yeah. The shiras ha-malachim is their hishtaikikos, it's their yearning, it's their craving. That's why the malachim are always singing, because they have this kisuf. Now, you see, really, you could stop here. This is very powerful stuff, what a niggun is. Yeah. But the Alter Rebbe never stops. So he says, this is really chitzainius. This is really extant. I want to explain to you. It's not so chitzainius. When he says here chitzainius, yeah, it's very primiistic. This is the whole avoid of the malachim. To say all the malachim are just, you know, it's just external stuff. But he's going, you'll hear what he says, and that's why he calls it chitzainius. Legabi, the primiist, it's called chitzainius. You know, just to say that the whole malachim, it's all just, you know, it's just fluff. He's not saying it's just fluff. It's chitzainius, legabi, the primiist. Now, what does this mean? This is all chitzonius. K'noida al derech mashal. He says, let's give a mashal. Misho oimet b'fnimi beis ha-melech. If somebody is standing inside in the chamber of the king, it's an intimate moment in him and the king. Malo lahagid l'sapa b'shvachai. What are you going to start singing about the king? You're with the king. Rakashay yetzi l'chutz. When you leave his chambers, you go outside, the oilam wants to know, nu. Oz yedabe v'yisapa b'shvachai. Now you'll start singing his praises. Lahafli, lahagdil, goydil, oitzim, shmach ha-melech, kamol gadol, omispoil b'chuli. Now we'll start extolling and telling the story, praising the king, how great he is, how emotional it is, and so forth. The avoid of rina, which represents the thirst, the yearning, ultimately intimates that there is a distance. When somebody is standing in the presence of the king, embracing the king in a moment of intimacy, they don't have the mental space to sing about the relationship. You're in the relationship. When there is tension, when there is distance, now you dream about the relationship. You crave, you yearn, you write books, you compose melodies, you write poetry, because there's a distance, there's a void. And the void is filled through music. Music fills a void. Good music fills voids. Music comes to answer questions or to question answers. One of the two. Music that doesn't come either to answer questions or to question answers is usually not worth the music notes. You know what I'm talking about. There's a certain genre of music that's just...
noise.
Huh?
Background music.
Black noise.
What? It's called noise. It's called manipulation of notes. Manipulation of notes is probably a better description. But there's a void here. And because there's a void, so you're trying to overcome a distance. When you're with the king himself, what zing still? What are you singing? So the malachim, huh? We learned in the Sukkos Maimer about Simchas Beis HaSheva, right? Mayim versus Yayin. Mayim versus Yayin. Eish versus Mayim. Yeah. Yeah. So even though the malachim are malachim, they have no other ava, they have no other chuk, nonetheless, they're still on the outside. Why are they on the outside? Because the light is restricted. Because the light is restricted, therefore we say they're still in a state of chitzonius. And because of that, they feel the distance, and that's what creates the music. Now, why is this called chitzonius versus pnimius? The difference between chitzonius and pnimius, in simple terms, means chitzonius is the outside, chutz. Pnim is inside, right? Pnim is the inside. There's two types of people. This is the lexicon of Chabad Chassidus, speaks about two types of people, a pnimi and a chitzon. A chitzon means somebody who lives for the outside. A pnimi means somebody who lives internally. I'll discuss it in a very simple and maybe very external fashion, which he's not addressing yet. I'm talking even more chitzoni. There are people that they're basically, what they do and they don't do is simply what the environment demands from them. What we call ultimate conformists. Anybody is familiar with this concept? People whose entire life is just a response to the outside. I'm basically reacting. We don't tell that to ourselves every moment because we wouldn't be able to live with ourselves. It would become disgusting. But our psyche becomes so accustomed to this type of life, you don't even know who you are anymore. You're just always responding. And if you grow up in a certain environment with enough pressure and enough brainwashing, enough indoctrination, enough penalties, enough threats, or enough incentives, you must become like that. And it's basically that you're not talking to anybody. Because that somebody is completely defined by others. And those others are also defined by others. And everyone is defined by somebody else. So your whole life is on the outside. There's nothing on the inside. A pnimi is very different. A pnimi, there's a lot of fluctuations because it's internal. It's internal. So sometimes a chitzin, in many ways, there's no relationship. You can't have a relationship because there's nobody to have a relationship with. But it's often consistent because there's no... Nothing disturbs him because he's just responding. A pnimi, there's aliyas, there's yiridas, there's who you are. I'm not always the same person. I have moments of up, I have moments I'm down. A pnimi struggles, a pnimi fights. But a pnimi means you're living internally, you're living inside. It doesn't mean there's no concept of altifresh menat sibur by a pnimi, there is. But it means that the pnimi is somebody who's internal, they live internal, they're in touch with themselves, and they challenge themselves and they work with themselves. That's generally the difference between a pnimi and a chitzah. On a deeper level, what it really means is, you know, they tell the mice about, they say there was once a mouse. And the mouse was living in a house, and everything was wonderful. The hostess of the people living in the house loved cheese, and mice loved cheese. Everything was wonderful. One day they decided, too many mice, to get a cat. Once the cat came in, the life of the mouse became... a nightmare. So the mouse prayed to God and said, why would you want to make my life miserable? So God said, what do you want? So I want to have security. I want to have confidence. He says, so what do you want? He says, turn me into a cat. So God says, no problem. Abracadabra could do. And the mouse became a cat and it was sussed in the simcha. One day, the owner decided to get a dog. Got a dog. Now the cat was miserable. The cat says, Hashem, make me a dog. No problem. You're a good kid. I'll make you a dog. Becomes the dog. One day, the owner decided that the dog is out of hands. He became a powerful dog trainer, and he starts disciplining the dog and zapping the dog, and the poor dog is miserable. God, help me. What do you want now? He says, make me the man of the house. If I'll be the man of the house, finally I'll have menuchas ha-nefesh. I'll be in control. He turns him into the man of the house. He feels confident, a macho, and then his wife comes home. Wife comes home, and she gives him a piece of her mind about himself. He's like, Ribbono shel Olam, what happened? God says, what do you want? He says, make me the woman of the house. The woman of the house, finally I'll be the boy. God says, no problem. He becomes the woman of the house. She or he standing in the kitchen with full tranquility, and suddenly she sees a mouse. I don't have to tell you what happens when Isha Tzitkane sees a mouse in the kitchen or anywhere else. Right? Of Ketzad Mirakadin. And it's not Lifnei HaKala, it's the Kala herself. So good. So the woman tells God, I can't even have menucha now. God says, what do you want? She says, make me a mouse. God says, that's what you were. That's what you were. So the mouse is trying to be the cat, and the cat is trying to be the dog, and the dog is trying to be the man, and the man wants to be the woman, and then the woman wants to be the mouse again. That's what you were. So the chitzo, sometimes people are scared of somebody who is scared of somebody else, who's scared of somebody else, who's scared of somebody else, who's actually scared of me. And that's the joke of life, right? People's fear of somebody who they think has an opinion and that person is just responding to somebody else, and ultimately in the circle it all comes back to the same person, so it becomes very comical and interesting and psychologically complicated or tragic. On a deeper level though, we have here the concept of chitzonius versus pnimius in terms of perspective. Whenever something is relatable to the outside, it's called chitzonius. Whenever something is relatable to the inside, it's called pnimius. So how many levels of pnimius and chitzonius are there? Infinite. Infinite. So the marshal, you'll have a teacher, and he has to give a shiur. The shiur is a very profound idea. There's the way he learns it to himself, would be called the pnimius. There's the way he teaches it. He has to dilute the wine with water, compromise the intensity of the idea because nobody will relate to it. So he's giving over the chitzonius of the sugya. It's not a bad thing. It's just he's giving over the external of it, the externality, the external layers of it. Why? Because if he would take them into the internal depth of it, the way he understands it for himself, which is the pnimius, it would be too overwhelming. That's why he says the whole rina of the malachim, it's a very deep experience, but it's called chitzonius. Why? Because it comes from a state of them being in an external relationship, meaning what they get from God is not his intimate self, but an external energy which fills them with a void and with awareness and with passion, and that's why they're singing. They're not inside the house, they're outside the house. Ayeh mekayim kvoideh. Yeah. Mesharis of shoyelim zelazeh, ayeh mekayim kvoideh. And Reb Nachman says that it's not a question, it's an answer, right? Reb Nachman says, Mesharis of shoyalim, shoyalim doesn't mean ask, shoyalim means borrow, from Lashon Shoyal. Mesharis of shoyalim zelazeh, ayeh mekayim kvoideh. They borrow from each other this awareness. Ayeh, in the question of where, that is the place where he is. In the question of ayeh mekayim kvoideh. Sometimes in the question you have him much more than in the answer. Because the question is what creates the song. The question is what creates the void. The question is what creates the existential angst and the pain of distance that allows a person to feel close. In ayeh mekayim kvoideh, because they're in a state of distance, and in a state of distance, the closest you can get is by feeling that you're far. The feeling of distance, that's somehow sometimes the closest you can get. And that's a very deep relationship. But it's a relationship based on the fact that there's a chitzonius element. There's an external energy that you're experiencing, and therefore you have the mental space and you have the void to be able to sink, to be able to yearn, to be able to pine. This is the hispilus of the niggun, the emotion of the niggun. That's why he calls it p'chinas chitzonius. Hu inyan. V'hu inyan mashakasov v'tzitkoscha yiranenu. We now come to the pasuk in Ashrei. What do we say in Ashrei? You remember? What's the full pasuk? Zeicher rav tuvcha yabiyu v'tzitkoscha yiranenu. So really Ashrei is one of those kapitlach that has bad mazel. I once saw an article by a non-Jew. So they asked him which poem moves him most. Which poem that was ever written makes him melt? So he says, Psalms chapter 145. So I was reading it and I'm thinking, wow. Tell a Jew Psalms 145 and he already experiences boredom beyond boredom. What's Psalm 145? Tehillah leDavid Arimim Chelakai HaMelech. Here we go. In fact, we want to give an example of saying something and not thinking, what do we say? Ashrei. But really, when you think about Ashrei, Ashrei is a very powerful poem, very powerful mizmah. So this man said that chapter 145 in Psalms makes him melt. You say it so many times a day, you stop thinking about it. So he's going to analyze here a few psukim from Ashrei. First is V'tzitkoscha Yiranenu. V'tzitkoscha, literally, your righteousness, they sing. We see that Yiranenu is connected to tzitkoscha. Why? Ki tzedek, hi malchus kadisha. The point is going to be here Yirananu can only be when we speak about Tzidkascha. Because we speak about Tzidkascha, therefore there's Rina. Based on what we learned, what Rina is, therefore Rina is only when we appreciate Tzidkascha. He said as follows, Tzedekim Malchus HaKadisha. This is a quote from Zoyar, Pasach Elio. Those who say Pasach Elio, Erev Shabbos before Mincha, as the minig of many, it's for the introduction of Tikkun Ezer, there's a lesson that Tzedek Malchus HaKadisha. Tzedek is the holy Malchus of Hashem. In other words, the Midas HaMalchus of Hashem is called Tzedek because Dina de Malchus Dina, Din is Tzedek, 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 Tirdoif, but Tzedek, Tishpoit HaMisecha. Justice is the idea of Din. A Melech has to build his empire and his Melucha on Din, on Tzedek, on justice. That's the key issue. But Tzedek, Tishpoit HaMisecha, Tzedek, Tzedek, Tirdoif, Vishavtu Asam Mishpat Tzedek, and therefore Tzedek is associated with Malchus. And therefore, the energy that comes from Midas HaMalchus is always restricted. It's with a clear din, which is always about a shear, a fixed amount. A din is always about a defined judgment and verdict. And he says, as a Maimer HaMuzger, Moiznei Tzedek Pirush Yesh Pchines Maznayim Sheshoiklim Pchines El Malchus Shamayim Shenim Shal Chalchat V'chad Ofim Shur Adolei. Pasach Elio, he says that Tzedek, Malchus HaKadisha, Moiznei Tzedek, which means Tzedek has a scale, in which all the energy is weighed, how much every person gets of the oil malchus shamayim, the awareness of Hashem. Uksiv, another pasuk tells us in Tehillim, tzedek molo yiminecha. Tzedek fills your right hand. What's the connection between tzedek and chesed? Ki malchus chamalchus kol olamim ksiv. The pasuk says in Ashrei, your malchus is the malchus of all the worlds. What does this mean? Literally it means, God is a king over all the worlds. You have a king, b'mei achashverish, he's moilich mehoidu vat kush. Malchuscha is Malchus Kol Olam. What's your empire? All the world is your Malchus. That's what it literally means. But Alter Rebbe is going to teicher a little deeper. That Kol Olamim, all the worlds receive their consciousness and energy from Malchuscha. All the worlds come from Malchus. Meaning, She'ein erech l'boidim nivrelius and avroim mekablim chayis min aboidiyus baruch. The truth is, there's no erech, there's no comparison between the Boiri, the Creator, and the Nivri, the Created, that the created beings could receive their chiyas from Hashem. For me, for you to give something to me, we have to have a common denominator. As we say in Yiddish, you have to have a common language. You have a teacher, you have students, they don't share the same language, they can't communicate to each other. Nothing I have, I can give you. Nothing you have, you can give me. Because this, it's like different wavelength. You know, sometimes you'll have a mentor, a teacher, they speak to students, but they don't understand him either. Not that anybody is bad or good, there's just no communication. The side of communication means we first have to establish that we share a platform, that we share something common. Your emotions are my emotions, your fears are my fears, your insecurities are my insecurities. That's why humor is a very integral part of communication. Why? Because when you're speaking to a crowd and the crowd mistrusts you, and of course Jewish crowds mistrust anybody who speaks to them, that's the essential to the Jewish psyche. Who is he? Who does he think he is? Consciously or unconsciously, the first thing you have to gain is trust. It's not about information. A lot of people don't realize this. They think they're going to say brilliant information. Nothing to do with information. If I don't trust you, I'm not going to listen to anything. The only way I could trust you is if you're vulnerable, if you're human. I have to feel that you connect to me. Humor, basically, what it allows often to do is we both laugh at the same things. We both deal with the same issues. Vulnerability, any form of vulnerability, humor is an easy form of vulnerability. It's not that vulnerable. But it's a certain form of, it humanizes the person. I don't take myself so seriously. Oh, you don't take yourself so seriously? That's good, because I'm not a serious person. So we could somehow connect. So there has to be a relationship. There's no giving to somebody to know. So here he's making a fascinating conversation. God has nothing to give us. He has nothing to give us. There's no erech between the Nivra and the Boire. It's not to say this is infinity, this is finite. Elai de b'chinas melucha. He has to become a melech. It's through melucha that he can actually connect. Shalafisho yizbarech melech aleim imchayim v'kayam. Imagine you give a shiur to a rock, and you expect the rock to absorb the shiur. You can't, right? In yeshiva, some of you have heard, there's a klotz, it's a klotz. You know what a klotz is? Piece of wood. Nobody ever told that? Okay, you're lucky.
No, no one ever told me it was a piece of wood.
Oh, okay, so now you know. You know, a klutz. If not, I'm not explaining myself well. But a klutz. No, look to the klutz. Yeah? He's never going to explain it again. Give another marshal. Give an, a klutz is a klutz. A klutz. He said once, the Beis Halevi once said, Afayid, he says, he has tremendous sayata d'shmaya. What's Sayyidina? He sits and learns 18 hours a day and he knows nothing. He says, for that you need Sayyata Deshmaya. To learn 18 hours a day, nothing should go and you need special help from heaven. So, disturb me. As a klutz, are you going to speak to a klutz? No, give a mushel, give an explanation. It doesn't work. Sometimes you're speaking to somebody and they're busy texting. It's not what you say, it's not how you say. There's no relationship. I'm not in your world, you're not in my world. It's not shaykh. Sometimes a chacham is speaking to a person, it's not in the same erech. He says, for us to experience divine life, it's not shaykh. Divinity is infinity. The nivra is a whole different reality, so therefore there's no erech. Unless Hashem identifies himself as a king, as a leader. A melech is a leader. Once he identifies in him the quality of leadership, the quality of leadership creates space for otherness. A leader by definition means, a real leader, you're in tune with your constituents. You're there for your constituents. So Hashem as a melech redefines divine energy into finite energy. It creates the commonality between the divine and the creation. So now the chiyus, the shir that he's giving, is relatable to me. It's relatable to me. It's relatable to my consciousness. Malchuscha malchus kol olam. Kol olamim can only be here because of midas hamalchus. Because of malchus. Because he's a melech, therefore they get their existence, and their existence is one that is defined, is limited, is restricted. It's my heartbeat, it's my consciousness. If I was feeling the full intensity of the divine, there would be no I, there would be no olamim, there would be only the boire. Ein soif excludes everything else. Your typhus? So it's midas hamalchus that creates. V'zeh malchus chamalchus kol olamim, and the next line, umem shaltecha b'chol dar v'dar. Olamim em chines makim. Dor is b'chines man. Hakel nimshach b'chines malchus. Malchus chamalchus of all space. Olamim is space. Memshalticha is your melucha, your ruler, b'chol dar v'dar is man. The whole world is defined by space and time relationship. Time and space. Dover Dover is time, generational, and Olamim is Olam, space, Makam. All of Makam and Zman, what's Makam and Zman? Definition comes from Malchus. Shade Azman, Va Makam, Him Nivroim, Mechadoshim, Me'ayin, Le'a Shekaidim, Briyasim, Lohayab, Chin Azman, O Makam Klam. Now you got to wrap your brain around this one. Time and space are created from nothing to something. Before Briyas HaOlam, there was no time and there was no space. In other words, before creation, there was no before. We speak about before creation, but really before creation, there was no before. The concept of before is also created. Which is how the Balatanya explains what he heard from the Maggid. Why Hashem decided to create the world 5,777 years ago. If it was such a brilliant idea to create the world, why didn't he do it 15.3 billion years ago? Or maybe 29.3 billion years ago? Or maybe sectillion years ago? Right? And the answer is, before Briyas HaOlam there was no Zman. The concept of Zman, of time, so you could say before, why didn't he create the world before? That's creation itself. Time and space is a creation. So when Einstein came and was Mechadish in our century, last century, and he got the Nobel Prize for the theory of relativity, that time is really part of space. Time is a dimension of reality. So here he's telling you, Makam and Zman go together. Makam and Zman, L'chayri, you think, what do you mean time had to be created? Well, time is not created. Time is a fact. Time is time. Time passes. God created, in time, he created reality. What about space? How do you create space? How do you create time? So he says, that's what you have to understand. All olamim, all space, and all dirt, the concept of time, is mechudesh me'ayin liyash. It's a completely a new bria. So in other words, the bria asylum is not a creation of physical material, of atoms, of molecules, of the physical matter that comprises the universe. No, the very definition of time and space, which are the boundaries of the world, the parameters of the world, within which matter exists, All that is created. There would be no way you can have created beings who are finite and they live within time and space, and we don't know how to go out of that structure. I can't go out of space and I can't go out of time. Aristotle once asked his students, who is the greatest teacher in the world? But he murders all of his students. There's no teacher like him, but every one of his students that he comes in contact with, he kills. His answer was time. There's no teacher like time, and there's no killer like time. So we can't get out of that. We're in the late mode of Gvul. Ela de b'chines malchusi is barak. Shebo shayach b'chines man, melach, Hashem melech, Hashem molech, Hashem yimloich. We always say in the psukim, right? Hashem melech now, Hashem molech yimloich. In melucha, suddenly we speak about time in terms of him. When he becomes a melech, in other words, when he identifies himself as a melech means you're a leader. You can't be a leader if you don't have anybody to lead. There's no relationship. It's concept of marriage. Malchus, it says in Kabbalah, is the feminine. Why? You can't be married to yourself. Although many people think they could. But in reality, even the Supreme Court, at least for the present is moida, that you can't be married to yourself. The law may change at some point. After all, most of us have split personalities. So why can't you be married to yourself and get a group discount? And there would be more shalom bias, because the arguments would be between your psyche and your psyche. So there wouldn't be hollering, there wouldn't be screaming, and so forth. But nonetheless, even modern world recognizes for marriage you need otherness. Otherness. And that means taking somebody else seriously, which is the challenge of marriage. Not to take other people seriously, you can't get married. I mean, you could get married, but you know what it looks like. You become a married man when you start taking somebody else seriously. Or to quote one philosopher who said, we don't love other people, we love our version of them. When I love my version of you, I don't take you seriously. I take myself seriously and I put you into me. That's not malchus. And you have two types of leaders. One leader, he's not talking about one leader, the only reason he's a leader is to feed his ego. So that's not malchus. I need you to be me. So actually I'm not a melech, I'm an evet. A melech means I don't need you to feed me, I'm fine. Therefore I can actually be here for you. Understand this. Malchus here doesn't mean what we call a king, Louis XIV, or Tsar Paul or Alexander. We're talking here, the concept of malchus means a leader. For me to be a leader, I have to be able to think about you. That means I don't need you to feed my ego, because if I need you, I'm not a king, I'm a slave. It looks like I'm a king, but really I'm a slave. Are you a king or a slave? Once I had a couple that came to me, so there was an issue over there. So the woman says, he never consults me, never talks, he's like a dictator in the house. He says, Rabbi Jacobson, why don't you tell my wife, this is a Rambam. People start quoting Rambams in therapy sessions, you know, it's tzaddis. Rambams, Gemaras, because then it's not them anymore. It's already God doing the job, and God tells them what to do. And once God tells you how to treat your wife, then there's nothing to do. It's over.
Divine right.
It's a divine right, yeah. He's like, so I say, what Rambam? I mean, I knew which Rambam he meant, but I played dumb. So Rambam in Hilchus is Surei Bia, that a woman has to treat her husband like a melech. In her eyes, he has to be a melech. Just explain this to my wife, that al pitayra, I'm the king. So I said, first of all, you should read the whole Rambam over there. The Rambam also says you have to love your wife as much as you love yourself, and you have to respect your wife more than you respect yourself. So how does that work with a melech? Then I said, let me explain to you what a melech is. A melech means that you're so confident that you don't need another person to feed your void, because you're a wholesome person, and therefore you could be completely dedicated to that person. That's what a king is. A king is so confident, is so wholesome internally, that they could suspend themselves and tune into the other person's needs. Tune into your world. If a king means I control you because I hate myself, so I need you to be subservient to me so I could feel good about myself. I'm not a king, I'm a slave. I'm being a king because I'm a slave. I'm completely a king means, I said, you have to understand what the Rambam is saying, something very, very deep. And he also says that the woman has to treat him that way, because in a very interesting way, women have the power to help men feel like this about themselves. Which feminism did not do so well in that sense. A lot of women forgot about their power. because they're trying to be men, so they forgot about the power of women. Okay, but that's a separate sugya. So the point here of Malchus is very profound. Malchus is where God becomes finite. Why? Because if I'm to be in a relationship with you, I have to create space for you. If not, it's not a relationship with you. It's a relationship with me. I'm not a melech. Ein melech b'loyam. So Malchuscha is what creates Oilamim, what creates B'chol Dor V'Dor. That's Bidus HaMalchus. And therefore, he's going to come back, as we'll see. This is what explains what Sitkosch is, what Yiraneinu is, which is the Avoid of the Malachim, which is still Chitzonius, as we will continue. Blessed is Masha'enkin Be'oilein Soif Baruch Hu Atzmoy Shekishmoy Kein Hu Ein Loi Soif. Kishmoy Kein Hu Ein Loi Soif. How does one grapple, how does one wrap their mind around the concept of infinity, of Ein Soif? The definition of our world is Soif, it's finiteness. Everything exists within the realm of finiteness. There's nothing that's not finite. Our faculties are finite, our perceptions are finite. And just as every piece of matter is basically consists of three dimensions, we speak about length, we speak of breadth, and we speak of height. There's a fourth dimension, and that's the dimension he's saying here, the dimension of zman, of time. So there's no three dimensions, there's four dimensions. Just like everything occupies space, which is called makom, everything exists in time. How does one appreciate the concept that there's something outside of time? Something outside of space? What does not occupy space? So we can have some musig of something not occupying space in terms of a svara. For example, take a svara sichlis, an intellectual, logical idea. There's a svara in Gemara, ha-moitzi mechaveri olavarai. Or it's a svara. It's a svara. Ha-moitzi mechaveri, the onus, the burden to bring proof. If you want to take away something from me, you have to bring proof, not me. It's a svara. Where does that svara exist? In your brain? And before your brain was formed, it didn't exist? Where is the makom of this svara? So obviously, it doesn't have a makom gashmi. It's not like the svara exists here in this base medrash and somewhere else not. It exists in the world of logic, in the world of idea. This is called makom ruchni, not makom gashmi. It exists in a makom ruchni, not in a makom gashmi. You can't give it a geographical space. In terms of physical matter, everything occupies physical space, geographical space. But now we have to understand the concept that transcends space, it transcends time, and not just physical space and time, but even spiritual space, even conceptual space. Seichel, Svar doesn't have a physical space, but it has a conceptual space. It exists in the world of Seichel. Where is that world? It doesn't have a where. It exists in my brain, it exists in your brain, it exists before our brains were formed, and after our brains. It's not limited to a certain space. But there's still a concept of makom ruchni. So here he says, just like that genius can't communicate with his student, why can't he communicate with his student? Because there's absolutely no common denominator, there's no sharing, there's no platform that they both share, and therefore there can't be communication. All communication is based on the fact that there's common ground, there's commonalities. I speak to your world, I speak to your mind, I speak to your heart, but I have to speak to you, not at you. If I speak at you, I'm not communicating with you, I'm communicating with myself. So therefore, I have to find me in you, and I have to find you in me. If I don't find me in you, I can't talk to you. And if I can't find you in me, I also can't talk to you, and you can't talk to me. So God can't talk to creation. What does it mean, talk? Here it doesn't mean talk. Here it means create. Here it means create. What does it mean, he can't? He could do what he wants. He could do what he wants. But what it means is, you want creation to be finite, and it should be divine, because it's coming from the divine. You have here a paradox. So the divine has to find creation in himself. In other words, he has to find the gvul in himself, and that's what malucha is. So whenever we say, all of existence comes from Midas HaMalchus means that the Ribbono Shel Olam Kivayochel identified within himself the quality of wanting to be in a relationship, which is Malchus, which is what a real leader is. A leader is a very deep form of relationship because, as I said, the leader is not seeking himself. If you're seeking yourself, you're not a leader, you're a slave. The leader is really there for the people. That's the definition of a leader. The Gemara says in Masechta Horeis, Ram Gamliel summoned two of the great Chachamim to become Parnesim, to become Nesiim, and they refused. And Ram Gamliel says, Kimeduma atem shashrar ani noisim lachem, avdus ani noisim lachem. You think I'm turning you into leaders? I'm turning you into slaves, into servants. What do you think leadership is? You think leadership is people serve you? Nobody serves you, you serve the people. So how tzichnish such miyuchasim? Don't, it's not such a chshivas. Or as Yeshua told Moshe Rabbeinu, kloyim, adoni Moshe kloyim. So Rashi brings, one of the berushim is kloyim is, you have enemies, you know what you do. Hatil aleim tzar chitzibur v'hem kolim aleim. Turn them into community leaders, that's it you need. Make sure they get elected as chairman of the board for the next meeting, and that's all you need. V'hem kolim aleim, the job will do it. Okay, so that's more in a humorous fashion, but the nekud is, a malchus is, if I become a melech because I need your validation, because I need the attention, because I like the publicity, then I'm actually a slave to my throne. I'm a slave to the people. So therefore, the real malchus is that I could suspend myself and be there completely for the people, in other words, tune in to you. So midas hamalucha is what creates zman and mokaim in elokus, and from that comes a world which is a divine energy that is defined by space and time, that is defined by Hashem Malach, Hashem Melech, Hashem Malach, Hashem Yimlech Lo'olam Vod, as we say in Shachris from the Psukim and Tehillim and Yehi Chvod and before Baruch Shamar, that there is the Over and there is the Hove and there is the Asit. So he continues. Mashaykin Bairin Saif Baruchuatzma, Shekishmoy Kainu Ain Loy Saif. Oirin Saif itself, like the name represents, Kishmoy Kainu, Ain Loy Saif, it has no Saif. Since it has no Saif, so therefore you need Malchuscha Malchus Kalaylamim Ulam Shaltacha Bachalder Vader. It's the Malucha, Midas Hamalchus, that allows for space, and Midas Hamalchus that allows for Zman. B'chol oylamim and b'chol dor v'dor. It's midas hamalchus that allows for both. This is all to explain zecher rav tuvcha yabiyu v'tzidkoscha yiranenu. So remember the mahalach here. He got into the issue of roni v'simchi bastia. The Zohar says ivdu as Hashem b'simcha boi lefonav b'rinona, simcha is morning, rinona is night. What's the difference between rinona and simcha? What is morning? What is night? So he explains that the avoid of the malachim and all the creatures, like it says in Perek Shir, is to sing. They're singing all the time. All song, he says, comes from an explosion of emotions, from a yearning, from a craving, from aspiration. Of course, there's songs that represent bitterness or frustration. There's songs that represent simcha. But there's the person experiencing something higher that they're clinging to, they're craving. That's what Shira is. And the malachim, their whole life, have this tshuka, this craving that never gets interrupted. Because there's nothing else to interrupt this ava. There's no gashmiyus to interrupt it. And they also don't have another avoida like Torah and mitzvahs. And therefore their whole avoida is rinona, to sing, which is the hishtoikikus, the craving to be included in the Ein Sof. And he says that nonetheless, he paskins up, this rinona is chitzonius. When you're in the house, in the chamber of the king, with the king himself, why are you talking about him? Only when you go outside, when there's a distance, that's when you start experiencing the song. So he starts to explain, this is v'tzidkoscha yiranenu, because tzedek is basically, the Zohar says, malchusa kadisha, which is like a scale, moiznei tzedek, tzedek molo yiminecha. So he starts explaining what malchus is. So now he goes weiter. Ulefi shahachayis, nimshech b'pchines malchusi yizborech, b'pchines tzedek, l'kach molo yiminecha, b'pchines yimin v'chesed. That's why the Pasuk says in Tehillim, Tzedek Molo Yiminecha, which literally means your right arm is filled with justice, your right hand is filled with justice. But he says, really what we're saying is something deeper, and that is, since the Chiyus comes from Malchus, so we understand why Tzedek Molo Yiminecha. Because Tzedek is the Bechina of Malchus, Dina, the Malchus Dina. It's based on structure, it's based on justice, it's based on verdict, V'shaftu Asa'am, Mishpat Tzedek. Tzedek Ihudin, and that's the scale, Midas HaMalchus, to make sure that everyone gets the chiyus that they need according to a midah, with a just shir, a midah, kol chad v'chad l'fim shir adalei, like a scale. And therefore, he says, Tzedek Mala Yiminecha. Why? Because since the Chayas comes from Malchus, which is Tzedek, so it fills your right arm, meaning it represents Yemin and Chesed, Kamayim and Mechalkel Chayim Bechesed. Since the Chiyus of all the Olamis is from Malchus, so that means Malchus is connected to Yemin, because the source of Chayim, Mechalkel Chayim Bechesed, is giving. So the Tzedek fills your right hand, because your right hand, which gives life, has to be through Malchus. If not, you give something that doesn't relate to people. So just like when a person communicates, you have to, which is a form of Chesed. There has to be the Tzedek, there has to be the Malchus, there has to be tuning into their world. This is the concept of Midas HaMalucha, Tzedek Mala Yeminecha. Yemin, which is giving, has to be filled with Midas HaMalchus, which allows him to become from Ein Sof, to redefine the energy as an energy that is relatable to existence. Uksiv, now the Pasuk says, Va'ata mechayes kulum mitzva shamayim lecha mishtachav, and we say this every morning. It's from the Nehemiah. Pirush, kilafi, sha'ata mechayes kulum lekach utzva shamayim lecha mishtachavim. P'b'chin is bitl v'hiskalulus. There's a hemshech. Va'ata mechayes kulum, you give life to all. And therefore it's utzva shamayim lecha mishtachavim. All the Tzva Shamayim, which represents all the heavenly troops, the heavenly legions, which are the angels, since they recognize that Va'ata Mechaya is Kulam through Midas HaMalchus, therefore Mishtachavim, therefore they prostrate themselves. V'hine b'chin is bitl zehu ba'erin soif baruch hu'anim shechum mislabash v'b'chin is malucha l'achayosim. This bitl, this dedication of Tzva Shamayim l'cha Mishtachavim, is that the Malachim are craving to connect l'cha, to bow down to you. So he says, because this bittel is ba'orein soif baruch hu hanimshech u'mislabash v'b'chinas malucha l'achayosam. The orein soif that comes into them, of course, comes into malchus. It's nimshech and mislabash b'malchus. And the recognition of midas hamalchus brings them to a tshuka, to reach Hashem Himself, ki elav eloy lemidoysav, utzva Hashemayim lechamish tachavim. When we talk about, there's an expression in Sifri, elav veloy lemidoysav, mila Hashem, b'chol kareinu elav, you call out to Him, not to His midas, you don't dive into His midas, you dive into Him. In other words, even though their experience is through Malchus, what they're looking is for Him, they're looking for Him in the Malchus. So, B'meila, what do we have here? We have the Vitzitkoscha Yiraneinu, the Hishtoikikus to Hashem that comes from recognizing Tzitkoscha. What's Tzitkoscha? Tzitkoscha is the Chiyus that comes through Malchus. This creates the Yiraneinu, this creates the song, this creates the Renama. V'zeo Zecher Rav Tuvcha Yabiyu Vitzitkoscha Yiraneinu. That's the Hemshech of the Pasuk. Zecher Rav Tuvcha Yabiyu. When you read these psukim, it's like, it's nice prose, but it's hard to understand the words. Zecher means the memory. Rav Tuvcha, of your tremendous goodness, Yabiyu, they express. Vitzitkoscha, your justice, Yiraneinu, they sing about. So he says, understand this pasuk in a deeper way. The pasuk is telling the whole story. Pirush. Tuvcha u ashpa v'chiyus shenimshach me'olam v'adolam. When you speak about Tuvcha, your goodness, what's the connection between Zecher, Rav Tuvcha, Yabiyu, Vitzitkoscha, Yiraneinu? Tuvcha represents the Hashpa Sachayas from Hashem to all the worlds. Mechal Kel Chayim Bechesed. That's what's called Tuvcha. K'may Shekasov Imru Tzadik Kitoiv. The Pasuk says, Imru Tzadik Kitoiv. Pasuk in Yeshaya. Tell the Tzadik that he's good. So he says, Sha'atoiv Ubchinas Tzadik Shua Makashra Mashpia Ma'ilam Vadoilam. Doesn't get into the details. I'll just say in Sifrei Kabbalah, it's explained that Tzadik is basically Midas HaYisoid, Tzadik Yisoid Olam. The concept of Yisoid is the connection from the Mashpia to the Mekabel. It's about an intimate connection between the giver and the taker. So Tzadik, which is Midas HaYisoid, is Mekashiru Mashpia Me'olam Vad Olam. It was what connects the flow of energy from the highest to the lowest, from the higher world to the lower world. So that is generally the connection between Toiv and the Mekasher from Oilam Ad Oilam. K'may Shekosov, Ki Kol B'Shamayim Uva'aretz. The Pasuk says, Ki Kol B'Shem L'cha Hashem Agdula V'Agvura V'Teferes V'Netzach V'Ahoyt. Ki Kol B'Shamayim Uva'aretz. So the Targum says, V'Targum Moi Da'achid. The Targum says on it, the Achid b'shmayo ba'ara, he's one with earth and heaven. So you have here the Midah of Yisoid, which is Koil. V'chasha magdula is chesed gvura tiferes neitzachoyt ki choyl b'shamayim uva'aretz. It connects Shemayim and Eretz. So it's the connection between the Mashpia and the Mekabel. So Tufcha represents your goodness, which is the flow of energy into the world. And Toiv is the concept of Tzadik, which connects all of the worlds. V'rav Tufcha is not just Toiv. Hainu kamer ribu revavis madregis adin ketz. Myriads of levels that are infinite. Shem b'chinas ishtal shalos v'yididis ha-madregis me'oylam v'adoylam. Ad sh'yoyir oyrin soif baruch hu b'chinas malchusoy lahavis ulahachis nevroyim adin ketz. Rav Tufche is the infinite evolution from one world to another world to another world to another world until the Eir Ein Sof goes through all of these transitions where it gets restricted, because Ein Sof itself is infinite, and then it gets restricted until it can enclose itself in what we call Midas HaMalchus and give Toiv to all of the worlds. And this is Rav Tufche. V'hinei Peter Zecher Rav Tufche, Kainu Shrak B'chines Zecher V'Arim B'chines Rav Tufche Yabiyah. And that's why it says Zecher Rav Tufche. All we can relate to is a Zecher, a memory, a Zikaron of Rav Tufche. Rav Tufche means the Eir Ein Sof itself, which is Ein Sof. A person cannot comprehend it. All he can have is a Zecher. For example, when a person has a Zecher, he remembers something. So it's not like a Zecher Rav Tufche Yabiyah is just a Zikaron. L'mashal has this brought a dugma. You mention somebody's name. So a person remembers them through their name. So how much of them do they remember? They remember something. Something of the name of the person. So Zecher Rav Tufche Yabiyu means that the Zecher of Rav Tufche they express with Ulekach Yiranenu. Shemishtoikikim v'nichsofim l'skala b'rein seif baruch hu sha'omrim ayeh mekoyim kvoida. That's why Yiranenu, what is Yiranenu? They crave to be absorbed in the Eir Ein Sof and they say, where is he? Ayeh mekoyim kvoida. So here we have the pasuk. Zecher Rav Tufche Yabiyu v'zit koschi Yiranenu. Rav Tufche is the infinite flow of energy that comes into the world. What do we express? Only a zecher of it, because it has to go through the process of restriction in order to be able to create a finite world. But Mela, what's the result? V'zit koschi Yiranenu. So when they experience Tzit Koscha, which is Midas HaMalchus, Yiranenu, this creates a song. And that's why they say, Ayeh Mekoyim Kavoide. They want to get absorbed in the Ein Sof. They're yearning because there is a void. They have no Asaga in the Ein Sof himself. Only the way he's defined through Midas HaMalchus, which is the source of the Chiyus of all creation. Vitzit Kascha, and the Vitzit Kascha creates the feeling of Yiranenu, of Renana, which is trying to overcome the gulf and trying to touch and be absorbed in the infinite. So they're very, very aware of the divine reality, and they sense that what they're getting is the Pchina of Vitzit Kascha, and therefore it creates the Kisufim, the Tshuka, which is what Rina represents. That's the meaning of the pasuk Zecher of Tufchi Abiyu v'tzit Koschi Yiranenu, because Malchuscha is Malchus Kol Olamim Memshaltecha b'chol d'ervader. Everything we know about existence, including spirituality, has to be based only on Midas HaMalchus, which is like the sieve. It's that converter, the adapter. Malchus is the adapter that adapts Ein Sof into something that's relatable to Sof, relatable to Zman and Makim. There could be Olamim, there could be Dor V'Dor, there could be time and space. Malchus is like the adapter, the converter, in which it adapts itself, the Ein Sof adapts itself to,
Adapts
itself to structure, even the highest spiritual structures.
This, the two have really the same idea, because Zecher Rav Tufche, Zecher, it's only the Ziv, Malchuscha by definition is also Ziv.
Right.
So it's just really the same, it's just a different phrasing of the same thing.
Right. And therefore it creates Yiranenu. And he says, Vizehu, this is the Pshat, Renona Beramsa. Now we go back, this is why the Zohar said that Ivdu as Hashem b'simcha boil the fun of Renona. Renona is at night. Simcha is by day. Meaning, Ramsehi midas laila. Rina is connected to light, to night, which represents darkness. Why? Because it's the darkness that creates the music. There's no music like the music that's created by darkness. That is the deepest form of Rina. Because the darkness allows a person to experience the void, the distance, and from that depth, Yoina, when he's in the stomach of the fish, and he says, Mima'amakim, from the depth of Sha'ol Tachtas, one reaches out. There's no song like that song, because that song captures the full tension of human existence, the drama of human existence. It fuels the profoundest emotion, because you're trying to overcome and deal with that void, deal with that darkness. So he says, that's what the Zohar means, Rinana, real Rina, Zimra, is created from night. What's the connection to everything we spoke about? Not that a person is in a void. Now, of course, voids exist on many levels, but the first void exists in Bchinas Malchus Yisbarach. When a person is experiencing Hashem's Malchus, Malchuscha Malchus Kol Olamim Miloshen Helam. Here's a new Taich in Olamim. We Taiched Olamim, your Malchus. So you have Malchus and Malchus has three interpretations. Pirush HaParshat is Malchuscha Malchus Kol Olamim means your Malchus extends to all the worlds. Achashverosh's Malchus is Mehoidu Vat Kush. Trump's Malchus is United States of America. Okay. Malchuscha, where is it? Kol Olam, this world, all the worlds. That's Beparshat, spiritual Parshat. Balatanya teaches Malchus, and of course not a stir, it's just the Oymet. Malchuscha, Malchus, Kol Olam means all Olamim, the concept of Olam, the concept of space, or the concept of time, Bechol Dor V'Dor, is only Malchus, only because of Malchus. Midas HaMalchus. And with the finite emerges, because the infinite needs to create space for otherness. Ein melech b'loyam. But he says, because of that, malchuscha malchus kol olamim, from the word helam. So the Gemara in Pesachim daf nun, I think, olam is miloshen helam. The word olam comes from the word helam, concealment. Zeshmi la'olam, so the Gemara is zeshmi la'helam. Kishem shani nichtov, ene kishem shani nikra. Rashi brings it. La'olam miloshen helam, concealment. Because of malchuscha, by definition, the highest spiritual experience in our world is dark. Why is it dark? Because it doesn't touch infinity. Because it's for malchus. So malchuscha, malchus kol olam miloshen helam. So that's why the level of the oir that's revealed to the malachim, which is midas hamalchus, it's midas laila. Why is it midas laila? Because the atzmius of the Ein Sof cannot be expressed, it cannot be manifested. Midas hamalchus creates the concealment, it doesn't allow the full energy to be communicated. So that's why rinona, which comes from malchus, always comes from a state of darkness. Now, of course, that's very high level of concealment, but from there already it trickles down, more concealment, and then till there's complete concealment. This is really Merumas in Gemara. It's a fascinating sushtel here between the Kabbalah and the Niglah. The Gemara in Masech Tebrachos, Tafir Aleph, the Gemara says, why do we say Yoitzer Oiru Voiri Choshech in Shachris? Who's talking about darkness? By night we speak, Asher Bidvoroi Mariv Aravim. Hamariv Aravim. He creates Erev. In the morning we say Yoitzer Oir. So the Gemara says, Sorich lahaskir midas laila b'yoyim. You have to mention the midah of laila, the concept of laila, even by day. He says, Dahainu k'mashim avur b'zoyer la'achlo l'chuli. Since he relied that everybody knew Zoyer Baal Peh, he doesn't even finish the sentence. The Zoyer says that in life you have to have la'achlo l'smola b'yamina. The left side always has to be submerged and included in the right side. In other words, the two midos, midas yoyim and midas laila, chesed, which is oyer, yoyim, and gvura, which is laila, ought to be integrated. There has to be a synthesis. What's pshat? Pshat in Gemara is, sha'idei shemasigim ha-choshech ve'helam shaloyrein sa'if baruchu, yoshes choshech sisroi, l'kachem mishtoikikim v'nechsof me'lov yizbaruch. Through the choshech, you can have the yoyim. When a person recognizes that the oyerein sa'if is concealed, in other words, Yoshes Choshech Sisri, which is a pasuk in Tehillim. He places darkness as his concealment. Hashem is in a state of Choshech. This creates the Hishtoikikus. This creates the Rinona. This creates the song. So therefore, you have to mention Midas Laila Bayoim, because it's the Midas Laila that allows the person to create the Yoim. Kamoshekos of Nafshi Ivisicha Balaila. Yeshaya HaNavi tells us in Perek Chavav, my soul craves you at night. Vasips at night. Vasips at night. Pirush. Sha'oimer la'kadosh baruch hu. Harei nafshi ata. A person tells Hashem, you're my soul. You're my soul. L'kachi v'sicha. That's why I crave you. B'pnei sha'chayis hazeh u'muster b'pchinas layla v'helem. Because it's all concealed in a state of night. U'l'kach tigdal ha'tshukr v'akosef li'yisi v'sicha. That's why there's such a unique, intense craving. There should be a v'sicha. U'kenoide, as it's known, sh'loi sha'yich avu tshukr l'savis taive ele b'misha chosir l'navshi adover shem esave elof. There's no ava without a void. There's no tshukr. There's no craving to have a real taiva to something unless you're missing it. Unless there's a void, there's an emptiness in your nefesh. So when somebody has it, he has it, there's no experience of it, there's no craving to it. The regish of tshuka comes from distance. When I feel the emptiness, I desire. So when the person, in the mashal that he said before, when the person is always in the presence of the one he loves, and there's always intimacy there, there's no tshuka, there's no kisafin, there's no ahava, because it's there. It's there. It's expression tainuk tmidi, einoi tainuk. Only when there's a distance, as David HaMelech says, tzamalecha nafshi, kamalecha besari. Why? Because I'm be'eretz tziyah v'oyev b'limoyah. Kain ba'koydish chazisich, as Baal Shem Tov says, kain is means halavai. Halavai, when I will be ba'koydish chazisicha, I will be able to look at you the way I looked at you when I was in a barren earth, in a barren land, Eretz Tzia V'ayif. Tzia means parched earth where there was no water. So that's why Yeshaya says, Nafshi Ivisicha Balayla. Now there's a very interesting diuk here that's easy to miss. Al pi diktuk, Nafshi, he says it as a derechaga, but it's very profound. Nafshi Ivisicha doesn't make sense in grammar, in Hebrew grammar. Either you say ivisicha balayla or nafshi ifsach balayla. Because nafshi means me, my soul. Ivisicha means I want you. Ivisicha, I want you. Balayla at night. So in English it would be my soul, I want you at night. Either you say my soul wants you at night or I want you at night. Either say nafshi ifsach balayla or ivisicha balayla. So Alter Rebbe teaches, look at what he teaches. Pirush ha'oim ala kadosh baruch hu, nafshi ata. It's two separate things. Nafshi is not him. Nafshi is God. Since you're my soul, therefore ivisicha balayla. Nafshi at. He said, not nafshi ivisicha. He's talking to Hashem. Since you're nafshi, what is the aside here? The aside, what does it mean to have a relationship with God? Since we spoke many times here, that avas Hashem is really ava to your ultimate self. Avas Hashem is really the ava to who you really are. It's not pshat avas Hashem is there's some creature in heaven that you said, now you got to love him. What? Love what? Who? What? When? Yeah. Every person has avas Hashem. You have avas Hashem. You don't need avas Hashem. You need self-love. If you have self-love, you have avas Hashem. If you hate yourself, you can't have avas Hashem. Avas Hashem means really the love of your true self. Nafshi, you're my soul. Because what is a human being? A human being is divine energy. A human being is divine infinite energy. But it's balayla, it's night. It's all concealed, it's all dark. Person doesn't feel their true consciousness. Person doesn't feel what their true soul is. It's a state of layla. And that creates ivisicha. So Yeshaya is saying that layla is actually what is the impetus, the springboard for the taiva, for the tshuka, for the craving, for the yearning. It's the void. So therefore, the Gemara says you have to be masker. Midas laila b'yoyim, because the yoyim comes through the laila. V'tzit koscha is what creates yiranenu. Zecher av tuvcha yabiyu, because malchus kolaylamim, that creates the yiranenu. However, when the person already has it, they don't feel the intensity of the yearning. And therefore, the real concept of song, which is about a yearning, it's about an aspiration. It's about overcoming a certain tension, either in a state of merirus or a state of simcha. Merirus means you mamash don't have it and you're bitter about it. Simcha means you feel that you can have it and that's why you're so happy. But it's coming from overcoming the void. That's two types of negunim. That is all the concept of rina. V'zeu inyin boyu lefanav birnana. This is the pshat when we say boyu lefun of birnan. So every word is mamish meticulous. What does it mean? Come before him, birnan. Why do you have to come? Because you have to show up. Me'mata lemaila. You have to come from a lower space to a higher space. Lotzis minar tekaguf. To extricate oneself from the sheath of the guf, ulavush and nefesh abahamis, and the cloaks of the animal soul, l'dofka bayus baruch to connect ayidei renana bepchinis ramso midas laila through renana which represents night he pchinis shemuster malubush ba'irin soif baruch bepchinis helam behester. Now we understand why it says boyu lefanov. You have to show up. You have to come be renana. In other words, you're not there. You have to lift yourself up and enter with renana. Why? Because the person is actually in a distant place. The person actually is in a state of Laila. The person is in a state of alienation. There's no relationship. But there's a yearning for a relationship. There's Laila. Laila means there's concealment. I don't feel. I don't know. I'm confused. Of course, Laila itself can have myriads of levels, how deep the darkness is. But even the highest Malach, who experiences everything, it's only Malchus. And therefore, they're looking for the renana, for the song. So when a person feels this ishtoikikus, so boyu lefonav, he shows up renana. V'zeu inyin baruch shem kvayt malchus elaylam vod v'yahafta. That's why the Chazal put in baruch shem kvayt malchus elaylam vod before v'yahafta. In Torah you don't have it. In Torah you go from Shema Yisrael, straight to v'yahafta Hashem alakach. But we know, as the Gemara says in Pesachim, that they instituted to put in baruch shem kvayt malchus elaylam vod before v'yahafta. Why? Because based on this, that Midas Laila has to be there in order to fuel the Yoyim, when a person understands that the Chiyus of all the worlds only comes from Malchus, where godliness is completely concealed, the Eirin Seif is completely not recognizable, which is why our consciousness is finite, even though it's all divine energy, because it's divine energy that's filtered through Malchus. And therefore, the Ein Seif element is concealed. Now in this world, even the Seif element is concealed. Even the limited energy is concealed. But even in the highest worlds of the Malachim, the Ein Seif element is concealed. So we understand that before Vahafta, you say Baruch Shem. Hainu, Shalavava Yavin, the heart has to comprehend. Ech Shebaruch, V'nimshach, Shem, Ha'orem, Eirin Seif Baruch Huli, is Kvoid Malchusay, V'ha'orahi, L'oilam Vod, L'mata Aden Ketz, the introduction to Vahafta is Baruch Shem. What is Baruch Shem Kved Malchus Elaylam Vod? Baruch, as he will say soon, means grafting. In Mishnah is Mavrich, a Mavrich as a Geffen. Brech is a pool. It means bringing something forth. So Baruch, what comes down is Shem. What is a Shem? A Shem is a Ha'ara Ba'alm. If I hear somebody's name, I can't know their essence from a name. A name doesn't tell me an essence. It tells me who the person is. I know their name, but it's only a name. Even on a deeper level, you say somebody has a name of something, a reputation, it doesn't capture their essence. In fact, more often than not, people's names and who they are has nothing to do with each other. Right? The Medrash says every person has three dimensions. There's who you are, there's who you think you are, and there's who other people think you are. It's very seldom that the three ever match. Who you are, who you think, then there's a fourth thing, who your wife thinks you are. Now that often matches who you are, but that becomes complicated a little bit. So who you are, who you think you are, in your name, there's your name for yourself, your name, like when you think about yourself, what do you think of? And then there's what other people think of you, what they think of. But it's nothing to do with you. So that's shame. So he says, Baruch Shem. What we have here, do we have God's energy in this world? Of course, the whole world is Einoid Milvade. But it's his name. What Pshat, it's his name? It's Chitzonius. What means Chitzonius? It's the way he relates to the consciousness of the world. So when we speak about God, we never speak about God. We always speak about ourselves. That's the Yisoid. When we speak about God, we're never speaking about him. We're speaking about ourselves. Just like when we speak about other people, we're not speaking about them. We're speaking about ourselves. When one can appreciate this, then one could get into a real relationship. When I speak about you, I'm not speaking about you. I'm always speaking about me. How do I really touch you? That's even with human beings who share so much in common. But still, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about me. I'm talking about your name. All I know is your name. I think there's somebody once said a line. He says, all we knew about, say, Avremel Finkelstein was that his name was not Avremel Finkelstein. Sometimes all you know about somebody's name is that it's not his real name. So that's what you can know about God. So Baruch Shem, now a name is very significant, because a name captures your projection. The world is not a small place. Va'ata mechaya es kulam. It's all you, but it's Baruch Shem. And that, why? Because it's Kvoid Malchus, it has to go through Malchus. What's Malchus? Ein Melech Belayam. And this is La'olam Vat. This goes down La'olam Vat, L'mata, then gets throughout all the worlds. In other words, this ray permeates every universe, wherever there's consciousness, to the lowest, lowest, lowest space. Therefore, Vahavtas Hashem Elokecha. What's Vahavtas Hashem Elokecha? It's the void creates an Ava. What's the Ava? That he wants Eirein Tzayf Baruch HaMamash. Liyas Elokecha B'chol Levavcha B'chol Navshcha L'davke Ruch HaBeruch. He wants that Havaya, which is Ein Tzayf, should be Elokecha. The two should become one. That your God should be Vahavtas Hashem, should be Elokecha. That should be your God. In other words, I should have a relationship with you. Not on my terms, but on your terms.
What's Kol Malchus and Baruch Shem then? Baruch Shem is it's only the aura, it's not the real essence. So what are the words Kol Malchus add to that idea of Shem? And why can't you just say Baruch Shmol? What's Kol Malchus add to the meaning of the idea?
You're saying it's redundant. Shame and Malchus is l'chayda redundant. Huh?
Can Malchus be beyond what you perceive in it, what you beyond perceive in the shame? Shame is just what you perceive.
You want to know what's Kvoid Malchus? What is it, Moisef and Shem? If it's a good harder. It's a good order. Let's leave it for now. But it's a good order. It's a very good order. So that's the Dov Kerucha Berucha. So the Baruch Shem is like the Laila again, which creates the Renona, which creates the Vahavtas Hashem Elokecha. Now, let's begin a few lines, another few minutes. Let's begin what he starts off the next step. This is all when you're going up this way. You're starting down and you're trying to come up. So boyu lefonov. You want to approach, there's always renona. There's a void and you sing out, you sing your void. And the Gemara is mechadish that there's a reason to celebrate the void because it allows for the music. It allows for the music. And then is Rinona. V'kach tzorech li is tchila avoyda sa'adam. That's always how avoyda begins. You don't begin any other way. What's the source for this? V'ayta ha-gemara in Shabbos ayin zayin. Ki b'riyosoy shal oylam b'reishach ha-shoycha v'hada nahayra. Now this is, again, he relies, you know, the Gemara. The Gemara says a very interesting thing. I think it was Reb Zeira. He saw that Reb Yehuda was in a very good mood. It was like the Gadol Hadar. This is whatever you want to ask, you can ask. It's like in a very open mood. So Zayda says, I have a question. What's his question? In a farm, goats always go ahead of sheep. Why? So he says, kibriyasu shaloylam, because that's how the world was created. First darkness, then light. So Rashi says that sheep are usually white, and most goats are black, dark. That's the end of the story. You have the greatest person of the generation says you can ask anything. What would you ask? If you get an opportunity to ask the greatest Jew, anything you want, what would be your first question? That itself is a good question to think about, right? What would be your first question? What's the lottery number? What would be the first question?
Why?
Okay, so his first question, he wants to know why sheep go after goats. he couldn't sleep for 60 years. So then the answer is much better, because that's how God created the world. First darkness, then light. So obviously there's a profounder element here. But the emes is that it represents a whole mahalach. So here he's meram is very bekitzer. That before simcha there's always renona. Before night, day there's always night. So he says that's how it starts. What's midas yoyim? Midas yoyim is the opposite. Midas yoyim is hamshachas oirin soif baruch hu mil maila lamata. This is how the ein soif comes down from higher to lower. Lislabish ba'olamis atzilis bri yitzir asiya p'chines ivdu as Hashem b'simcha. This is not boyu lefon of birnona. This is ivdu as Hashem b'simcha. It's not the chiyus that Hashem gives in a concealed way. It's that the ein soif directly comes down into the world, and when a person experiences this, it doesn't create renona, create simcha. That's why simcha is in the morning. Shazal yisra na milas an neshama sal hamalach. And here's where the neshama trumps the malach. Shamalachim ein lem rak pchinas rina bilvat. The malach only has rina, and the neshama says rina. She pchinas halav is kalos mamata lamaila. The malach goes in one direction. Milmata lamaila. That's why the Gemara is so astonished that Yaakov's malachim were oilim v'yardim. But be'emes is, that's the avoid of a malach. It's oila. He's always oila. And when he's oila, he's yoyded and he's oila. It's always mamata lamayla. It's one direction. In other words, he's trying to get out of something. He's trying to go up. Always trying to go up. And that's why he's singing. Mashenke neshamas Yisrael, yashlam avoyde noisefes. They also have the avoid of rina. Shabbos will have that, and that's the starters. The starters is it starts with night, but they also have another avodah. What's the other avodah? Pchinas hamshachem al ma'ila lamata me'ahelam al agilui. The opposite direction. The hamshacha that comes from higher to lower, from concealment to revelation. Not from darkness going outwards, upwards to light, but from a higher state of something which is in an aloof state to come out in gilui. Shekol simcha is galos hapnimis. And that's what simcha is. There's a difference between song and simcha. All simcha is always, the pnimius gets revealed. That's what joy is. Famous expression, ain't simcha kataras asvekas. There's no joy like when the svekas get resolved. Whenever pnimius, an inner truth comes out, that's what generates simcha. To put it in other words, simcha versus depression are not emotions. You don't have chesed, gvura, tiferes, netzach, hoyd, yisoyd, simcha, or atzmos. Rather, atzmos, depression, blocks all emotion. You don't know who you are. What simcha does is, it removes, like when you have leaves blocking the sewer. You remove everything, and all what's internal could emerge. That's what simcha is. It's galus apnimius. That's why you see, when people are in a very happy state, their full self emerges, things that they didn't even know about themselves or things that they tell somebody that's really from them. But usually there's blockages. What simcha does is, it is this galus apnimius and it affects this galus apnimius. And that's what simcha is. So therefore, renona is on the contrary. Renona comes from the void, from the distance, from the yearning. That's what creates song. Kisufin, nichsavam kal sanavshi. That's what a real niggin is. A niggin is paying tribute to yearning. It concretizes, not it expresses the kisuf, and that's what a nigun is. That's why it's brought, he brings that nigunim without words are much deeper than nigunim with words. Because lyrics, even very sophisticated and profound lyrics, always contain the energy. A nigun without words, you don't even want to be defined by words. It's a different type of communication. A nigun without words, Baal Tanya was a big composer. So a lot of his nigunim are with words, like Avinu Malkeinu, Keliata, Koil Doidi Doifik, where you hear all these experiences, by the way, in his nigunim. But then he has nigunim without words. The famous one is the Dalet Bavis. the famous Dalet Bavis, without words dafka, because there's no words. Why is there no words? Because the kisufin are more infinite, they're profounder. Simcha is something else. Simcha is the pnimius comes out. But mela, one is malmata lamaila, yearning, and one is malmaila lamata. Malmaila lamata is that the higher, deeper, inaccessible, unconscious reality emerges, and the person is overwhelmed from joy. It's a state of ecstasy, it's a state of intimacy, it's a state of oneness, when the outer becomes one with the inner. In Rina, the outer is frustrated by not being one with the inner. In Simcha, the outer becomes one with the inner, because the inner comes out into the outer. Into the outer, there's an element of Simcha. That's the definition of Simcha. And this is an avodah that the neshama has that the malach doesn't have. How the neshama experiences, it'll continue. But that's a separate avodah of Simcha that comes dafka in the morning, not at night.
This class is brought to you by the yeshiva.net. Please help us continue the classes. Make even a small contribution at www.theyeshiva.net/donate.